Oh well. There's a title underneath that. So my talk is entitled From Trowels to Headsets. And it's a bit of a meander around some of the work I'm Alan Miller. I'm from the University of St. Andrews. And it's a little bit intimidating talking to a room full of archaeologists about archaeology, as I'm not an archaeologist. I come from a computer science background, but have an interest in cultural heritage and digital interpretation with cultural heritage, and been playing around with some of the things that you were talking about as well, photogrammetry and the like. And this is work we did with David Strachan from Perth and Kinross Heritage Trust, and also as part of the Tay Landscape Partnership, which is a big landscape partnership around the Tay, as you might have been able to infer from the name. And so I thought it'd be great to be able to kind of come up here and to share some of our experiences and some of the work that we've done. And that's the site of Morden Top, where they used to be a Iron Age, I was going to say in the olden days, but an Iron Age hill fort of significant strategic importance. And over a number of years, excavations have been conducted on that. And that was probably the most significant project that was part of the Tay Landscape Partnership, involving large numbers of archaeologists and volunteers over the years in uncovering that. So the reason why the title didn't come up was because I started the video. So yeah, from trowels to headsets. And this is David, and we'll just give him a... Oh! There should have been a... Oh, anyway. These are two of the archaeologists, and these are just to bring home that there really were trowels involved in the process, and proper archaeology was taking place on the hill fort. Now, we engaged with a number of processes to create media. So one of them was photogrammetry, both using the IKEA thing, although we didn't buy it direct from IKEA, we bought it from Amazon, which saved on a trip to IKEA and postage, but it only cost us £12 rather than £4.99. So using aerial footage of drones, using 360 photography in different ways, a nice little theta thing, and also digital SLR, and also making 3D reconstructions, 3D models inside of game engines, and combining that with interviews of people, straightforward photography and video work. And I think for me, one of the sort of most exciting things that is happening in the world at the moment is the way in which, these processes, and I understand, unfortunately I couldn't be with you this morning, but I understand there's been quite a lot of discussion of the sort of democratization or the potential of democratization of photogrammetry, and that I think kind of extends across digital media, stuff that, in the past you would have required huge amounts of equipment, costing vast amounts of money, and probably wouldn't have been allowed near it without years of training. Today you can kind of pick up and go. Although I think you rightly said, I mean, our experience with working in communities and doing workshops with photogrammetry is that it's kind of harder than the 360 stuff, because with the theta you can just go click, whereas the photogrammetry, how would I put it? You have to know how to do photography in order to get good results from it. So, somebody, it's kind of like an enthusiast thing. I wouldn't expect, if I walked into a museum and was talking to people there, for everybody there to do photogrammetry. But I think it would be great, if every museum or every archaeology site had 1, 2, 3 people who were able to do that and who were skilled in it. Sort of skill set that you could easily add on to somebody who, an amateur or enthusiastic photographer and those sorts of things. And actually, you know, I say that, but I mean, that's what's happening, isn't it? It's pretty much happening all over the place. That's the game engine. So one of the things that we do is to essentially try to assemble all of this media in different ways so that people can engage with it and make sense of it. And part of that, through a couple of European projects, one called CINE and one called EU LACAN, which has a European Union, Latin American and Caribbean. So one's a sort of Arctic project and one's a Caribbean project, which is quite good. So we get to test our equipment in different environments. We took a laser scanner to Jamaica without, it didn't like it. Didn't like it at all because we were working in small museums and it was too hot for the laser scanner. And we tried turning a fan on it, which was great. The fan, like, you know, it made the laser scanner happy and it was nice and cool. But it meant that it was wobbling all the time, which isn't what you really want from a laser scanner. So we lugged this around Latin America, but actually all the stuff we did practically was with photogrammetry, which kind of shows the flexibility that's involved in it. But in these, we're kind of interested in, like, how can you take these different media and use them, and how can you make it so that all these people who are doing photogrammetry or all these people who are flying drones around the place and all this sort of stuff, that's all fantastic, but then what? You know, you've got your 300, and Sketchfab is great, right? It's wonderful, but it's quite limited in terms of what you can show for the metadata, for the description, and also it's they're putting up the prices, and they're restricting the functionality, which is like, okay, it's bearable at the moment, but will it be in 2 or 3 years' time? But thirdly, I don't know if you talk about working with small museums. You know, a lot of places in museums, the internet is just rubbish. Yes. You know, it doesn't work, and we found this because we went around Latin America doing these workshops. Well, this is how you do photogrammetry, and here's it up on Sketchfab, and oh, you don't have an internet connection. We can't show you it, and all of that sort of stuff. And so I think that means that there's kind of like a space for designing an infrastructure that will help, that will tie all of these things together and help people who are, you know, going out and there's this fantastic cat. I've got a 3D thing of it, and it's brilliant, and it's on Sketchfab and all of that sort of stuff. So how does that then become part of a learning process in a school? How does it become part of a exhibit inside of a museum? How does it become something that is accessible to people? I mean, it's always accessible to people. Like, you're here, you show us it, that's great. But then when you're not here, you know, how can people interact with it? And so that's the sort of thing that we've kind of been working with. So as part of that, we've been trying to design this, an infrastructure that will help people to do this sort of work. And that, we kind of call it like virtual museum infrastructure. So the idea is, if you want to make a virtual museum, here's something that will help you in the process of doing it. And that includes, I mean, things like the workflow that you were talking about, you know, actually having a workflow, because it's an easy process. These things are easy processes to learn step by step, but you kind of have to know what each step is, and then that, you know, so it's an easy process, but it's hard to make the process easy, if you see what I mean. It's that once, if you can tell people what to do and what the different steps are and lead them through it, then that's straightforward. So like a toolkit, how-to guides. The internet is fantastic with all of the different, you know, this is how you do this is how you do that, and all of those sorts of things with YouTube, and that's how lots of people learn. But if you want to learn photogrammetry, you know, from the internet through YouTube, there's loads of brilliant material out there. But there's more stuff that really isn't that good, you know. And so, you know, it's not really fair for somebody who's like, oh, I've got my camera, I want to go out and do photogrammetry, to have to figure out what's the good stuff and what's the bad stuff. So, you know, that has that sort of filtering process, but at the same time has a way of safely archiving the data. You know, you can do photogrammetry at high resolution or at low resolution, but what happens with so many projects is people go, click, 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 click. I've got my 360 thing. I've got my photogrammetry. That's fantastic. I'll load that up to Sketchfab. poof, and then everything else goes away. And so then, you know, in 5 years' time, when somebody's going, oh, that thing of the cat that we saw that was so impressive at the conference that was on Sketchfab, how do we get a copy of that? Or now phones can do 3 trillion resolution screens. How do we up the resolution on that? Because when I uploaded it to Sketchfab, they limited it to 200 megabytes or whatever the limit was at the time. But 200 megabytes now sounds great, but in 5 years' time, you know, everyone would be working in 200 gigabytes, and so it's going to look old. But the photographs that we took, that were taken in the first place, could have, you know, been rerun to generate a much higher resolution, a much higher resolution model. So archiving the sources as well as the stuff, as well as the stuff that's up there, and then getting everything together all in one place, so that you know, there's the photogrammetry, there's the aerial photography, there's the personal interviews, there's the 360 images, there's the games and all of that sort of stuff. Getting that all into an archive, so that it's then possible to make use of them in different outputs. And with the Tay Landscape Partnership stuff, we work with a couple of museums, Perth Museum and with Abernethy Museum, making an one of the exhibitions was called Pics and Pixels, which for us was great because, you know, so many digital projects, you know, the problem with them is that they're digital projects. You know, they're kind of special, separate, big, expensive, groundbreaking, or any of these sort of things, right? But actually, what I believe is that digital projects, they shouldn't be special, they shouldn't be big. Okay, it's great to be groundbreaking, but you can't be groundbreaking all the time. And sometimes it's not that useful. You know, the first telephone wasn't a particularly useful device. It wasn't until lots of people had them that it became useful. If you're talking about small, medium museums, then, you know, how does this become part and parcel of the everyday life, of the workflow, of the processes that are taking place? And so the idea of doing a Pics and Pixels exhibition, which had, like, you know, Pictish stones and 3D models of the Pictish stones that had artifacts and digital reconstruction of the fort with the artifacts, with digital representations of the artifacts embedded in it, seemed to us to be, you know, a really nice way of moving forward. And the other thing we did with this recreating Morden Top, do you remember summer? And the summer solstice. So we all went up there on the summer solstice with mobile phones and Google Cardboard, and we were able to, you know, put the two things together, put the mobile phone and the Google Cardboard together, and stand on the top of the hill and see the digital reconstruction geolocated of the area that been excavated, and to, you know, look around inside of the fort from four or five different points. So as well as doing sort of exhibitions inside, you could do this landscape, you know, on the spot, outside stuff. And then the third kind of output that we used as part of this work was just the creation of a website, but a website that is able to incorporate all of the media and use interactive mapping, so that you can go to the different places and see what media there is which represents each of those places and each of those stories. How am I doing for time?
7 minutes.
I've got 7 minutes left.
Of the 20.
Okay, that's fun. That's fantastic. Yeah, and Sketchfab's partner, I suppose, is Roundme. People are as familiar with Roundme as they are as Sketchfab. We call them social archive sites. You know, so you've got YouTube, Roundme, and Sketchfab. They all have one type of media that they kind of specialize on, and Roundme is great for doing like 360 tours. So this is, well, it was in an app, but it's also on Roundme. And it's deliberately nighttime because it was the summer solstice and they were all up there. But you can create a tool, put interpretation on it, put audio on it, and be able to then jump from one place to the other place, which is great both as a way of representing a site and generating interest in it, but also it's great as a collaborative tool. We found it very, very useful in terms of we were wanting to develop an app and to develop installations and the like. And this enabled us to collaborate, even though we weren't in the same office. And that's the virtual reality app that uses Google Cardboard to give you an on-site representation of Morden Top as it would have been in AD 50. Somebody using it was against a background. And then I suppose the other side of the headset thing was to do it in an exhibition setting. And here is very different because we've got a computer with a graphics card, high fidelity and all of that sort of stuff. So the sort of workflow that we did for these two different headset applications was to do the photogrammetry, create the media, make a landscape, and embed it all inside of a 3D game environment. Now, the game environment that we used is Unreal 4, which is quite nice. It's free. The source is freely available to it, so you can do a lot. With it, and it's kind of professional grade. So a lot of games have been made with using it. But there's others that could be just as effective. One of the things we liked in particular about Unreal 4 and where those sort of games have gone to is the ability to do landscapes on a bigger scale than we had done previously. So the first, like 5 years ago when we were making 3D reconstructions of places, we would kind of stand in the middle and go around and take lots of photographs, so we could put the photographs around the reconstruction to give an idea about the scale. But with Unreal today, we can do hundreds of miles, not just us, the system can do hundreds of square miles, which means that, in a landscape setting where when you stood on Morden Top and you're looking around, then from survey data or OS data or other data sources, we could create a digital landscape for as far as the eye can see in pretty much all scenarios, which is very nice thing to be able to do. And then, what's fantastic is then to be able to build your reconstruction and pull all the media into it and to be able to walk around it and to be able to explore in that way. But there's limitations because if you've got you can do that, but you'd need to have like a virtual reality ready computer, which implies it's still a commodity computer, but it implies spending between $1,000 and $2,000, on the computer. And if you want to do that sort of thing in a small museum, actually it's within reach. But if you want to do it on a mobile phone, it's not. You can't have that scale and that level of free movement. So the approach that we adopted, for the mobile apps was what we kind of like describe as the viewpoint approach. People, we didn't just kind of pluck it out of the head, we did some experimentation. And generally, when people are walking, they're not looking around. Okay? If you look at people on the street, they tend to be fairly focused on, going to a particular place. And then when they stop, they kind of look around, and see what's going on. And so we kind of mimic that in our apps. We either we have a series of viewpoints that have got 360 photographs in them, and the 360 photograph can be quite high resolution, and it has to be high resolution because if you want to get the detail that you get on a an HD screen 1920 by 1080, because you're only looking at a portion of the image at any one time, you have to, for example, to use that sort of resolution, you need to have an image that is something like 13K by 6K in size, maybe 20, depending on the angles that you're using. But something like 13K by 6K, anything less than that, and you're kind of like, you're doing time travel, going back in time, but not in the way in which you would like. Because you want to go back in time travel to see the world in huge detail. Here you go back in time travel, to the 1990s, to the resolutions that they use for the screens. But the great thing about doing the photogrammetry, doing the spherical image, having this viewpoint thing, is that you can get the resolution that's required for 1920 by 1080. If you're doing 360 video, you know, getting above 8K, getting to 8K is really difficult. Getting above 8K is virtually impossible, both in terms of getting the camera and getting the platform to deliver the thing. And you know, the minimum that really works is 4K, but it doesn't. It's not really great, I don't think. What we tend to do is have these, yeah, stop in a place, be able to do the 360 stuff, be able to see your artifact, click on your artifact and bring it up and turn it round and do all this sort of thing. So you can have your cat sat on the mat, and then you can click on the cat and you can bring it up and you can twirl it around and investigate it in more detail. And then we tend to, for going from place to place, we tend to just use flat video, possibly 3D video rather than 360. So I had a sign which said finished, and so I think I finished.